Joining us now for her take on the markets, Cristina Gabaldon of Sun Life Philippines. Hi, Cristina. Good morning.
Hi, Mimi.
Okay, so Gabs, I wanted to start with this. We have this just in. March unemployment numbers are already in, are out rather. And for March, the unemployment rate came in at 7.1%. That translates to 3.4 million jobless Filipinos. That is slightly better than February's 8.8% unemployment. Do you think that the market is going to cheer this, or it's not good enough?
Well, we are cautiously optimistic on this number. Mm-hmm. This is the lowest rate recorded since April 2020 when lockdowns were imposed. Since there's a lockdown in mid-March, I think we should watch out for the coming numbers in the next few months.
Oh, okay. So that's for the jobs. Now, let's take a look at the broader market. We're back to 6,200 yesterday. By the way, I just wanted to share to you, Gabs, and to the rest of our viewers, the market just opened. We're in the first few seconds of trade, and we are in the green, up by about a fifth of 1%, 11 points, 6,310. So we're back to the 6,300 level amid, you know, yesterday we did fall 1%, nearly 1% because of elevated inflation, 4.5%. So what's your favorite strategy at the moment, given inflation remains high, interest rates remain low, and you've got a patchy vaccination rollout?
Okay, so our strategy is to have companies that would benefit still from a reopening, but have those names that are resilient in case we go into lockdowns. We employ a bottom-up strategy. Mm-hmm. So our index target is actually 7,650 from yesterday's close of 6,299. That's a 21.41% upside that we see. As for inflation, we think it's plateaued. Inflation came in at 4.5. Year-to-date inflation is at 4.5%. It was driven by meat and transportation, but on meat prices, at least the government is doing something by removing the tariffs on pork imports, and that should ease inflation pressures.
Okay, Gabs, did I get this right? You're looking at an index target of 7,650. That's about a 22% upside for the year end, right?
Yes.
And do you think before we get to that number that things could, you know, turn for the worse before they get better, or this is it? This is it. We've seen it. We've reached the bottom. We've reached the floor. Now it's only going to be a slow climb up.
It's hard to say, but yeah, we're hopeful that this is the bottom. At the levels of the PSE now, it's at 16.14 times, quite attractive already.
Okay, 16.14 times. Okay, P. Cristina, the central banks, let's talk about central banks. The BSP is going to be meeting for their policy meeting decision next week. That's May 13. The central bank did have a reaction to yesterday's inflation, saying that the latest outturn is consistent with expectations that inflation will remain elevated this year before settling close to the midpoint of the target range in 2022. At this point, is the Philippine central bank friend or foe of stock market investors?
Of course, they are friends of stock market investors. The BSP has done 200 basis points rate cut since the pandemic, mm-hmm. and also reduced reserve requirements by 14% to 12%. Mm-hmm. They have actually done a lot of the heavy lifting during this pandemic. And, you know, lower rates are good in general for the equity market. Corporates are able to borrow at lower rates. And in terms of earnings yield to bond yield, the spread there is quite attractive to go into equity. Well, with the loan moratoriums and credit card caps imposed on banks that, you know, are part of the equity market, well, we think it's necessary in order to help the SMEs and consumers in general.
Okay, so let's now talk about some of the interesting corporate stories that we have from this morning. Let's start with San Miguel Food and Beverage. They just released their first quarter earnings figures, and the verdict: net income up 66% to 9.7 billion, as revenue went up by 11% to 76.4 billion. San Miguel Brewery, it says, saw flat revenues. Ginebra San Miguel did see a surge in the top line, 52% surge. And their prepared and packaged food segment remains a bright spot with a 6% growth. Very quick reaction to San Miguel and how attractive this stock is right now.
We think FB, or San Miguel Food and Beverage, actually beat earnings expectation, consensus earnings expectation at 35% of full year estimate, as well as EBIT. It is at 32% of full year estimate. So GSMI and San Miguel Food did well, while the brewery segment might have still been affected by lockdowns. That's why.
The quarantine
growth. Yes, correct. Which is really on an on-premise consumption type of product, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, with restaurants closed, it's not really a surprise. How about this? Still on another food company, RFM, which is behind Royal Pasta, Fiesta, Selecta Ice Cream, reporting that for the first quarter of this year, net income also jumping 51%. Food is on a roll, clearly. Net income there, 423 million, revenue up 9%. They're actually citing sustained top-line growth in milk, pasta and flour, and they did see a rebound in ice cream and institutional bun line sales. I imagine the ice cream segment's going to be a big push this summer because I can feel the heat.
Yeah, I think most of the consumer companies are coming off a low base. That's why you're seeing good numbers right now. Also, they could have benefited from the passage of the CREATE bill.
Okay. That's interesting. And still on earnings, this one is an LPG business. Well, 95% of their business is an LPG, Price Corporation. Net income also up, not too much, just 6% to 423 million. Revenue also up 9%. They're saying they did see sales volumes growth in LPG of about 6% and a 9.5% increase in the average LPG contract price. Quick comment.
I think this has to do with the lockdowns and the work from home status that we have. People cooking from their homes.
Yeah, more people, you know, discovering they could actually be chefs, or they can open these small businesses in cooking or baking.
Correct.
Okay, are you one of them?
I try.
Same here. I try but don't succeed. Okay, finally, Mega World also this morning announcing that it's allocating 36 billion pesos in capex for this year. That's 29% higher than 2020's actual spending. In fact, for context, last year, before the pandemic hit, they were supposed to spend something like 60, 65 billion. They cut that down to 36 billion. And even that amount, they didn't completely use up. That's why they only used up, 27, 28 billion, which is why this is 29% higher than the actual spending from last year. What does this tell us when CapEx remains at these levels? Because I remember about 2-3 years ago, Megaworld did say that they plan to spend 300 billion in capex for the next 5 years. If you divide that, that's 60 billion a year. They're just allocating 36 this year.
Well, there is a lot of uncertainty right now. So a lot of companies have actually cut their capex. As for Megaworld, we think this is just a continuation of projects that were delayed from last year.
Continuation of projects, but no new projects. Not that many, at least.
Yeah, maybe, perhaps.
Okay. Okay, let's go to a foreign story. Very interesting. The 27-year-old Russian-Canadian programmer who created Ethereum, he's 27, guys, in 2013. At the age of 19, he did Ethereum, has now joined the Billionaires Club as the cryptocurrency hit a record high of $3,500, record high. What is your take on, you know, cryptocurrencies? You know, Bitcoin used to be the hot stuff. Now you're hearing more about Ethereum or Dogecoin. Should we be seriously looking at this, at adding this to our portfolio?
I think we should be looking at it. There's definitely more institutional adoption to cryptocurrencies right now. For Ethereum ecosystem and the like, there are many use cases for it, such as remittances, yield farming, investing in stock tokens, online gambling, games, and even art, wherein maybe you could buy digitized art.
Yeah, I saw this. Yeah.
By NFTs or non-fungible tokens. As for BTC or Bitcoin, it's perceived as a store of value, something like gold, but more liquid. Actually, between the two, Ethereum and Bitcoin, I have a preference for Ethereum because of the use case for it. Although a drawback to it would be the high gas fees or transaction costs, but they are going to address that soon, and people are eagerly awaiting the development in this with their launch of Ethereum 2.0, possibly next year.
Ah, exciting times ahead for those holding these tokens. Okay, Gavs, let's now go to the most exciting part of this conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about this stock that you're monitoring closely. I know that you like this. Don't tell us, just describe. So what do you have for us this morning?
Okay, so this stock is in the telco space. It's a beneficiary of the work from home. It is focused on fiber fixed broadband. It is expanding in the Bismin area.
You're giving it away, Gabs.
Yeah, I think I'm saying too much, but we like this stock.
Okay, you like this stock, but what sort of upside are you looking at for this stock in the next 6 to 12 months?
We're expecting very high double-digit growth. That's in the perhaps next 2 to 5 years.
Okay, when you say very high double-digit growth, is that in the teens, in the 20s, in the 30s?
Actually, it's like 40 to 60%.
40 to 60% upside in the next 2 to 5 years. Did I get that right?
40 to 60% growth. But
growth.
Upside, our target price for it, I believe is, no, maybe I'll not mention it here.
Okay. Can tell me in private later.
For the name, yeah.
Okay, we got that. Thank you very much, Gabs, for joining us. So we're going to have to guess which stock this is. Wow, 40, 60% growth in the next 2 to 5 years. Impressive. Thank you for joining us and stay safe. We hope to see you soon.
Thank you. Thanks, Mimi, for having me.